Modern aerial bombing is a lot like giving birth, and not just because they both involve a lot of pushing. See, modern military aircraft fly much faster than World War II bombers, which means relying on gravity alone to drop bombs not only is insufficient, but can also be catastrophic. When bombs are dropped from an aircraft, especially at higher speeds and lower altitudes, they may not necessarily go down. That's because the air underneath the aircraft moves more slowly, creating a higher pressure area that pushes the aircraft upward. So a bomb that is simply dropped may bounce back up and hit the aircraft, which obviously is a bad thing. This is completely opposite to how most bombing accidents happened during World War II, where a higher altitude bomber dropped munitions onto a lower flying friendly bomber. In the modern jet bomber era, bombs can travel sideways, potentially striking nearby aircraft flying to their side. And that's why, instead of dropping bombs, modern aircraft have to push them out. We'll get to premature delivery and post-operation damage assessment too. But why modern bombs are sometimes pooped out from cargo planes? Why some of the bombs are tossed up instead of being dropped down? How dumb bombs were made smart using light? And why penetration is getting much harder for aerial bombs? Is not what you think. Before dropping bombs, the F-35 must open its weapons bay doors, which is a technological miracle in and of itself, considering that the aircraft flies at Mach 0.09. In fact, the bomb bay doors on both the F-35 and F-22 can open even when traveling at supersonic speeds of Mach 1.5 and above. You might be wondering how these doors don't just rip up at such high speeds. Well, that's American defense engineering for you. And according to the comment section, the reason why Americans don't have free healthcare. Nevertheless, when the munition separation goes right, it's fast, it's angry, and it's ready to ruin someone's day. While this bomb separation from the aircraft looks effortless and incredibly smooth, it's actually really hard to achieve. A premature delivery can be catastrophic. In fact, before any bombs get paired with the bomber aircraft, a lot of scientific research must occur in order to prevent this from happening. This research includes countless separation tests that are conducted over drop pits and wind tunnels, using various bombs and aircraft types. A special movable support beam moves the test munitions as it would in real flight. During these wind tunnel tests, everything is accounted for, including how the munition would behave around the weapons bay doors while traveling at various speeds. The information gathered from such tests helps identify any potential problems and offers solutions to make sure that the bombs fall down and not upward toward the bomber itself. Only after these experiments have been concluded can the aircraft drop bombs during live flights. The bombs are secured to the aircraft with a specific mechanism called the ejection rack, which serves a dual purpose. First, it holds the bomb secured to the aircraft. The second function is to push the bomb away from the aircraft. Aside from missiles, which are self-powered, all other munitions have to be physically pushed away from the aircraft's slipstream with the help of 4-inch pistons. While there are many different types of ejector racks on the market, some of them use small pyrotechnic devices which tend to be the most reliable. Yes, they literally blow up small explosive devices in order to drop bombs from the aircraft. Now, to be precise, these are small gunpowder cartridges that detonate upon receiving an electric charge and kick the pistons, which in turn push the bomb away from the aircraft. This way, the bomb doesn't get sucked into the airplane's slipstream and doesn't fly against the body of the aircraft. But why not just poop bombs from the rear of the bomber so it would be impossible for them to collide with the aircraft? A few decades ago, the technology to open bomb bays at supersonic speed did not exist. So one possible solution was to position bombs at the rear of the aircraft. In fact, the A5 Vigilante had a bomb bay that was positioned between its two engines. A small explosive charge would push the nuclear bomb away while traveling at supersonic speeds. This gave the bomber enough time to escape the nuclear blast. So technically, the bomber would just poop a nuke. Super duper nuke pooper. But the invention of modern weapons bay doors meant no more nuke poopers, since ejector racks could safely drop the nuclear bombs from an F-35 while flying at supersonic speeds. That said, pooping bombs is still a thing. As part of the Harvest Hawk program, a Marine KC-130J was turned into a bomber, B-130, with the addition of 10 common launch tubes at the rear of the aircraft. However, this required the crew to go on oxygen inside the depressurized cabin in order to launch precision-guided munitions. But later, this problem was fixed with the conversion of a side door to hold two pressurized launch tubes to drop bombs from the side of the aircraft. Eventually, the rear door was replaced with 10 launch tubes, which turned the C-130 into an explosive poop monster. The C-130 drops GBU-69, which can be pushed out of the common launch tubes or alternatively dropped conventionally. The GBU-69s deployed from the launch tubes of the AC-130J are capable of quietly reaching targets from standoff range. These glide bombs are specifically tailored for Special Operations Forces missions, as they can hit moving targets. Ensuring that bombs don't hit the bomber upon being released is only the first step. The next challenge is to hit the target accurately, and even harder than that is to penetrate a bunker, a topic I've saved for last. In order to better understand the accuracy of modern bombs, we need to know how inaccurate conventional bombing is. Bombing a target accurately is complicated, because airspeed, direction, wind, and atmospheric conditions greatly impact the fall of munitions and where they land. In fact, a World War II bomber flying at 20,000 feet had less than a 2% chance of hitting a 100-square-foot target. Due to this inaccuracy, it took hundreds of bombers to attack a target in World War II. This also meant that civilian casualties were almost unavoidable. Similarly, during the Vietnam War, aerial bombing remained highly inaccurate. In fact, in the case of Tanoa Bridge, more than 600 American aircraft flew over 800 sorties, trying to destroy the bridge. And they kept missing it while they lost 10 of their own aircraft over the course of 3 years. But with the invention of laser-guided bombs in 1972, it took just one day for 11 F-4 Phantoms armed with 24 laser-guided bombs to destroy the Tanoa Bridge. The destruction of the Tanoa Bridge was a pivotal moment in history of aerial bombing, because from that point forward, smart bombs set the new standard of how aerial bombing should be done. Today, smart bombs are also called guided bombs, guide bomb units, or simply GBU. During Operation Desert Storm in Iraq, precision-guided bombs were responsible for destroying 40% of all the targets, while they only accounted for 10% of the total bombs dropped. GBUs are incredibly accurate, to the extent that the US Air Force once dropped a 2,000-pound bomb inside a building's elevator shaft in Baghdad. Modern laser-guided bombs, or LGBs, rely on the Paveway series kits, which transform dumb bombs into smart bombs. This is how a laser-guided bomb works. A targeting pod on the aircraft or someone on the ground paints the target with a laser light, and the bomb seeker detects and tracks the reflected laser energy to guide itself toward the target with the help of control surfaces at the rear of the bomb. Dumb bombs had a circular error probability of about 400 feet, but laser-guided bombs had a CEP of just 20 feet during the Vietnam War. The one downside of the LGBs is that they don't work in adverse weather conditions. That's because the laser may not be able to illuminate the target in rain, fog, or a thick cloud cover. As a result, the true game changer was the GBU-32 Joint Direct Attack Munition, or JDAM kit, which could be paired with conventional Mark AD bombs. The GBU-32 was guided by inertial guidance coupled with GPS that commanded the tail control system. JDAM has an accuracy of 16 feet and a range of up to 15 miles. Note that the JDAM extended range version can reach 45 miles, which can deliver the HIMARS rocket range with heavier warheads at a lower cost of just $35,000. The biggest advantage of the JDAM kit is its all-weather functionality, whether there are clouds, rain, or snow. This may address accuracy, but how can you extend the range of a falling bomb? If a bomb needs longer range, you can turn it into a glide bomb by adding wings. For example, the AGM-154 Joint Standoff Weapon glide bombs have a range of up to 80 miles. But this comes with a higher price tag and can cost upwards of $750,000, depending on the version of the bomb. Of course, nothing beats the range of air-launched cruise missiles, with a massive range of 1,000 plus miles. That said, they carry smaller warheads, not to mention that they're over 10 times more expensive than smart bombs. The biggest advantage of cruise missiles is that, given their long range, they significantly reduce the risk of the bomber aircraft being shot down. An important step after dropping bombs is damage assessment. Was the target hit or not? But bombing doesn't really need to be super accurate if you're deploying a nuclear bomb. A nuclear explosion devastates such a large area that being a couple of hundred feet off target doesn't really make a difference. That said, beware of dangers of a premature delivery, which could result in the bomber aircraft itself being hit with a nuclear blast. This is why toss bombing was invented. In order to buy more time for the bomber aircraft to escape, the bomb is tossed up into the air, which then follows down on an arc path. This buys the pilot sufficient time to escape the blast range of a nuclear or other powerful conventional bombs. That said, toss bombing is no longer needed, because bombs keep getting smaller. Modern smart bombs are so accurate that they no longer need to carry a large amount of explosives in order to neutralize targets. This led to the creation of small diameter bombs, or SDB. SDBs weigh a mere 250 pounds, and instead of carrying one 2,000-pound smart bomb, most US military aircraft can carry four SDBs. This allows for destruction of four different targets instead of one during a single bomber sortie. Another benefit of SDBs is that there is much less collateral damage. First-generation SDBs, such as the GBU-39, have a range of up to 69 miles and accurate to less than 3 feet. The second-generation SDBs, like the GBU-53 Stormbreaker, have an active seeker, which allows them to strike moving targets in all-weather conditions. But what happens when the bomb finally reaches its target? What happens after reaching the target depends on the type of fuse used in the bomb. Most fuses can be set to various modes during the bomb-building process. First, there is a proximity mode, where the bomb detonates at a certain height above the ground. This is useful when destroying large structures, since the explosion causes a massive blast wave. The impact mode is when a bomb explodes upon hitting the target. This is good for destroying hardened structures like roads and runways by creating a massive crater. Finally, there is the delay mode, where the bomb explodes seconds, minutes, hours, or even days after the impact. Delay bombs are typically used against tunnels, caves, and bunkers in order to give the bomb sufficient time to first penetrate deep inside before detonating. Alternatively, delayed bombs can be used in evil mode, which has a delay ranging from a few hours to a few days. This is used against personnel who come afterwards to survey the damaged area when suddenly the bomb decides to blow up. You might be wondering, how can bunker busters penetrate hardened targets so easily? To penetrate deep through 20 feet of concrete, the bomb needs a few specifics. First, it has to be made from extremely hard steel, which allows it to keep its shape as it penetrates the concrete. For example, the GBU-57 Massive Ordnance Penetrator is made from Eglin steel, which can withstand pressures of up to 193,900 psi. For comparison, A36 structural steel, commonly used in buildings and bridges, can handle 36,000 psi. And 4150 ordnance steel that is used in gun barrels has a strength of 75,000 psi. Second, bunker busters are thin and have a small diameter compared to their weight. Think of bunker busters as a nail that goes in but doesn't split the wood apart. And third, as previously mentioned, bunker busters use delay fuses so they don't explode on impact. Instead, upon impact, the delay fuse is set to detonate, but only after the bunker buster has reached a predetermined depth. When combined, these three design elements make bunker busters an incredibly effective weapon. If you're deciding between a career in mechanical engineering versus civil engineering, there's an obvious choice. But the game isn't over yet, because civil engineers are fighting back. In order to stop bunker buster bombs, you have two options. Make the concrete layer thicker, or make it stronger. Can you guess which is more practical? The GBU-57 Massive Ordnance Penetrator, which weighs 13.6 tons, can reportedly go through 200 feet of 5,000 psi reinforced concrete. Now, that's a very, very thick layer of concrete. But going from 5,000 psi to 10,000 psi, you only need a 25-foot layer of concrete. So making stronger concrete is the way to go. And that's exactly what civil engineers have done. The new ultra-high performance concrete is 4 times stronger than traditional high-strength concrete. The ultra-high performance concrete doesn't use rebar. Instead, it uses millions of small metal fibers, which give it a strength of over 30,000 psi, compared to traditional high-strength concrete of 5,000 psi. Currently, the strongest concrete in the world has a strength of 50,000 psi, which was achieved under laboratory conditions. So, hypothetically, you'd need a relatively thin layer of the strongest concrete in the world in order to stop the most powerful bunker buster ever made. Or you could just target the bunker's entrances, which would also put it out of commission. Hey there, we are hiring. If you think you're a scriptwriter who can match our caliber of research, or if you're a video editor who can source quality footage like we do, we're looking for you. Click the link below to apply and become part of Not What You Think.